www.protectourdefenders.org. Also, protectourdefenders.com is an organization working to help bring justice to victims and to take the decision-making out of the chain of command. Also, be sure to follow the STOP Act, H.R. 3435. You can also email stopmilitaryrape@house.mail.gov. Thank you for tuning in. I'm Val Ibarra at Mutiny Radio. Thank you, KPFA. Thank you, Women's Magazine. And remember, just when your aspirations seem outrageous, that inspiration is contagious. Peace and thank you.
KPFA team for our largest, most exciting annual off-air event, the KPFA Crafts Fair. We need friendly and reliable volunteers to help at doors and assist exhibitors and visitors at the fair. In particular, we need volunteers for Friday, December 7th, from 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. This event takes place at the concourse at 8th and Brannan in San Francisco, and it's a great opportunity for you to attend as KPFA's guest in thanks for working a three-hour shift at the Crafts Fair. If you'd like to pitch in and sign up for a shift, call Mickey at 510-848-6767, extension 629. Or email volunteer@kpfa.org. That's 510-848-6767, extension 629, or volunteer@kpfa.org. As always, we appreciate your help and hope to see you there.
These are your listener-supported radio stations, KPFA,
KPFB, Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. It's time for About Health.
Good health and welcome to today's edition of About Health. I'm your host, Dr. Michael Norm. Glad to be back with you today. I certainly hope you had a nice period last week. I left on Tuesday and got back on Sunday and didn't see a drop of rain, but I assumed much fell here. I just was not able to experience that, but I think those of you who did, I know that you welcome this for all of the good things that it does. But glad to be back with you today. One thing before we start our program, The flu is on its way. It's in Texas and Louisiana, Mississippi, in that area. It's a particularly virulent strain of flu. Should get here in a few weeks, so that those of you who are concerned about that and is sufficiently to get a flu shot should certainly consider it. But the flu is here in the United States, and they say it's a pretty virulent strain, so take that into consideration. Interesting program for you today. We're going to do a lot of updates if we have the time to talk about some current issues in health. But first of all, we're going to have an interesting conversation, I'm sure, with Anita Chantel Woodley, who we happen to reach through a Facebook connection, a former patient of mine who's gone on to do one of wonderful things. I don't know, Ms. Woodley, how much of that I'm going to take credit for, but some of it at least. She's an Oakland native, San Francisco State alumnus, award-winning actress, journalist, writer, director, improv performer, and virtual artist. She's toured the world in a woman show called Mama Jugs, the Breast Health Show, and The Men and Me, Our Fathers, Our Brothers, Our Sons, weaving more power and compassion into their story. She's based in Chapel Hill now, travels the world, but really interested in her approach to breast cancer, her own experience, and how she's dealt with that experience. Ms. Woodley, welcome to our program.
Thank you for having me.
Well, I'm glad to have you. Tell us a little bit about yourself and how you got interested and what made you interested to share that story in breast cancer.
Yes, well, I um, I'm Anita Woodley, and I grew up in Oakland, California, in a couple of places, but the last place we stayed was on 13th Avenue, 17th, near Foothill. And so my mother had breast cancer when she was 37 and was afraid to go back to the doctor once they said they saw a bump under her arms, as she said. And she didn't go back until she passed out at the bus stop on 14th and Broadway. And all the red and white blood cells were gone, and I had just started college. And at that point, I wanted to do something to help her. And, you know, the cancer metastasized, and it was just not going well because she didn't have the treatment. And that is when, if you fast forward maybe 10 years after she passed away at 47, I wanted to remember her, so I took out the VHS tape that I recorded of her at her doctor appointments and created this show called Mama Jugs to remember her so that other people can step over that fear and get the help they need and not die needlessly.
Tell us a little bit about the play and how you've woven it in to your journey around your mother's cancer.
Yes, well, it's a play. I portray my 100-year-old great-grandmother who talks like this, doctor, and baby, and I portray myself at 17 as well and at 27. And with my mom, I think the most important part of her performance, or it wasn't a performance for her, it was her real life, because what you hear is me taking the VHS tape and repeating the things that I heard from her. And I have the changing of the breast in there, which I think is very important, because most people say, I thought breast cancer was like a pimple. I didn't know all that happens when they remove your breast. And I'm like, well, sure, you have to drain the liquid somewhere. It all has to go somewhere until it heals. So what's happening is people are being brought into the world. It takes place in our living room on 13th Ave. That's what I've recreated. And they get to actually experience it, get to hear her songs that she sings to God, and hear her get upset, and hear her laughing and joking. All these things that go into her within 10 minutes, you get to really know who she is. And then I get to show the mini documentary of her at the doctor office, so you can see how her appointments actually become the play.
You know, now sometimes when you present people with these very stark reality experiences, especially in the theater, there are some people who are, how do they respond to it? And especially how do breast cancer survivors respond to this play?
They really enjoy it. I mean, they come up to me, for instance, I was at York University a month ago, and the woman walked up to me, and she just pursed her lips, and she said, you telling my story, huh? You just gonna get up there and just tell my story like that, huh? And then she gave me a big old hug and was pumping me in the back. You know how they hit real hard when they're hugging?
Yeah, I know that.
You're like, ooh, that hurt.
Yeah.
But she said, you just keep doing what you're doing because you're telling our story. And then I've had people who have lost folks that are kind of like, I don't know if I want to see this. And then when they see it, they're happy they did come. However, there was one lady when I performed in Oakland, she wrote on a note card that she did not understand why everybody was laughing, because nothing's funny about breast cancer when she lost her sister 2 months ago. And I didn't get a chance to speak with her, but if I would have, I would have definitely told her that, you know, maybe it was too early to come see the show, because I didn't find the humor and what happened with my mom, and to see the light in her situation until 10 years later. It took that time for me to process it and then see the beauty of how she behaved under those circumstances. And then I want to share one more thing. I met a lady at a library performance, and she was pretty standoffish in the show because I have improv, and I talk to the people in the audience. But she came out to my car when I was driving away and said, you know, I'm 50 years old, and I've never had my breast checked ever.
That's really quite remarkable.
Yeah, I couldn't believe it, and she's a pastor's wife.
Now, as you go through these the shows that you do, are you giving what are you giving information about breast cancer? What in terms of the message, other than the fact that your mother was young and strong and had to go through these experiences, shared experiences? What are the other messages that come out of your from your performance?
Well, one of my favorite ones is I tell people, well, my great-grandmother character tells people to do the hula hoop and the wave on their breast. And you don't just do it in October either. You do it around the year. So she takes the concepts of breast cancer awareness and puts them in plain English, as she would say. And that way it makes people say, oh, when I leave here, I'm going to go and do that. Or she reenacts the breast exam and how the machine, she says, the machine mashes your breast, and then they go chicka and turns around and then mash the breast. And she talks about all of that, and it makes it funny, but at the same time, it takes the fear out of putting your breast on a machine that's a plate of glass that smashes it down. And Grandma talks them through how to deal with that. So I take all the things that your doctor would tell you and then have Grandma and the different characters tell people so that it's not about doom and gloom. It's about inspiration. It's about surviving and also doing preventative measures like, you know, self-breast exam, all these things. And they don't even know, like, initially that it's an educational thing because it's just part of their lives. It's part of the character's lives.
Anita Shontel Woodley is our guest. She's an award-winning solo performer, journalist from Oakland. She has a one-woman show. I keep pushing it that way, but called Mother Jugs, based around her mother's experience with breast cancer. If you want to talk to her, we still have a few more minutes, and more if you need. 848-4425 the 510 area code 1-800-958-9008 1-800-958-9008 is our 800 number. Tell me a little bit, I noticed that in reading through some of the places you've shared this story not only in America but in other countries. And what was the transition to get there, and what was the response?
Yes, well, it took me performing 21 shows in living rooms and churches and everything to get to Cameroon, Africa, the University of Yaoundé. And I initially was going because I wanted to meet my tribe in the bush, the Tikar people, after our family had the DNA testing. And they absolutely loved it when I got there. I mean, I didn't expect that they would even understand because they speak French, and I was speaking English. Some of them spoke English. But it went over very well, and I'll tell you, my luggage was held for ransom. They wanted chocolate bars. So my luggage was held for ransom, so I didn't have my props or my bodysuit or my afro pick to pull my afro out, which is what I do for the show. And I did it in jeans and a T-shirt. And it still translated well, and that's when I realized it's not the props and the things that you do, it's the way that you're being when you perform the show. And so I had people come up and start telling me about losing family to cancer, or that they're going to check their bodies, or asking, should I be checking my body in college? Is that important? And I'm like, yeah. You got to get familiar with it so that you know when it changes. So it was a great journey. I got to meet the pygmy people and got a naming ceremony where they call me Princess Becca, which is boomerang to go and to come, because I was the first since enslavement to return to the bush in the village.
All right. I have one question from Christina in Oakland. Christina, you're on About Health.
Hi. I just wonder if there are any performances locally that are going to be happening.
Yes, well, I don't have any scheduled right now for Oakland. I'm coming December 19th through the 2nd, and Marcus Bookstore in San Francisco will allow me to do 15 minutes to introduce the people at their Kwanzaa celebration to do snippets for Mama Jugs. So there will be a mini version of it at the Marcus Bookstore on 12/31 at 6 p.m. I'll be performing with Augusta Lee Collins. And I'll also have the full Mama Jugs DVDs there that were shot in L.A. on HD camera. So you're welcome to come and get the DVD and see it. And if someone books me in their living room, I can always tell you about that, too, because I perform in living rooms as well. But so far I haven't announced that I was coming to Oakland. This is the first time everybody's hearing that I'm coming back home.
Mm-hmm. Do you have a Facebook page?
I do. It's Mama Jugs Show. So that's MamaJugsShow. And the website is MamaJugs.com, MamaJugs.com. And I'll post everything there. So if someone books me in their living room, I'll definitely let you know. They're usually cool with people coming by.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you.
And what would you like to see happen with your play? I mean, what would be your best outcome, your greatest wish for your performances?
Yeah, my greatest wish would be to perform for survivors throughout the world, to hook up with the oncology associations and the pharmaceutical companies and all those places that have a lot of information, but they need a way to get it out to the people in a way that people accept it. That's my biggest dream, is to reach more people on a larger scale. Recently, one of my dreams came true about performing at universities, and I have something scheduled for Penn State and Indiana State, and all these schools are coming forward to say, come and tell our students about it. But my dream is just to reach on a large scale, especially the states with high mortality rates, like Mississippi and D.C. and West Virginia. I would love to go to those places to perform, because people need this message so they can get out and get the help that they need, if they need that type of help.
Well, give us again how people can learn more about your work.
Yes, so they can go to my website at MamaJugs.com, and that's MamaJugs.com. There's videos there. I was just on PBS, so you get to watch a 20-minute special with me and a cancer specialist. And you can go on Twitter, Mama Jugs Show, and also on Facebook, Mama Jugs Show. And LinkedIn, Anita Woodley, which is W-O-O-D-L-E-Y, and Anita's common spelling, A-N-I-T-A. And we'll talk and chat. I always post videos and pictures. There's a lot of fun stuff out there on the website.
Now tell me, how long is the performance when you do it in homes?
How long is it? It's 60 minutes.
60 minutes, okay.
Yeah, so it lasts for an hour, and all they need is 15 friends together, and each person usually pays $20, and I do the whole show. I don't cut it down, and my show fits in a suitcase, so I'm able to transform whatever little spot. I've been in teeny apartments, and they're sitting right next to Grandma, and she'll turn to the character. People sitting next to her, how you doing, sweetheart?
Well, certainly give us a call when you get here. We're glad to have a local young lady do well, and proud of all your accomplishments, all your awards and Emmys, and your relationships through the media, and especially proud of the way in which you've chosen to honor your mother's memory. And so thank you very much for taking the time to join us.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
You're more than welcome. All right, 848-4425 is the number, the 510 area code. We're going to be opening up the lines for anything that you're concerned about. 1-800-958-9008. We can talk about anything. If you've got an issue, a problem, something left over from a previous program, we're here for you. Like I say, I'm not the smartest person in medicine, but I do know a lot of smart people in the healing arts. And so if you've got something, we usually can steer you at least, answer a question in at least a superficial way, and then help you to move on into a more accomplished type of healing system. So 848-4425 and 510 area code 1-800-958-9008. As far as I know, this is the only place where you can call and get a, you know, kind of a quasi second opinion, get some information that you might be able to use to expand your health status, improve your fitness guides, take care of a problem, or help someone else. So one more time, 510 404-872-5. It's your turn, your time, and I hope that you will take advantage of it, because if you don't, I'm just going to sit here and talk wildly here for the next 30 minutes. So one more time, 510-884-4425, 1-800-958-9008. A couple of things. Let's get started on things that interest me until I get to things that interest you. First of all, certainly this flu issue is no joke. It's understood that this is going to be one of the worst epidemics for a while. I mean, that means with potential. So you got to get ready, even if you're not interested in the flu shot, which I think could be a mistake. Washing your hands in between chores is very important, especially in public places. Hanging around too long for people who obviously have symptoms of flu, it would be a good idea. But just kind of get ready. I think some of the remedies that we all use, I mean, I can remember my mother was a great castor oil person. And no matter whether you got flu or whether you got pneumonia or heart disease, you always got Bengay and castor oil. And I'm sure some of you still have some of those same old remedies around. But I think you should be prepared just in case, especially if you're over the age of 65 or if you have some other underlying serious condition. A lot of the top news stories now responding around Christmas and the holiday season, let's say it that way. A number of toys have been out there now, and safe toys that have made the list. The ones that are at the top of the list, I thought you might like this, the Dora guitar because it's too loud, the Dora backpack because it's too complicated, and this is this robot that also is troublesome because of the pieces and sometimes the electrical equipment as well. The other thing you have to recognize is that you're going to hear these things every year about the whole issue of Christmas depression. I think that there's no question that the holiday season is not a popular time for many, many people. And they do kind of get depressed during the holiday season. I think that there are a couple of things that we always talk about simply because I think it does tend to give some comfort and guidance to some people. And one of the things is certainly you don't want to be around negative people during the holidays. That's first thing. And I know you got to realize, I mean, this is hard to say for me, but I'm going to say it anyway. All relatives shouldn't be together. I mean, let's face it. There's some relatives that just should not get together. I don't care whether it's Christmas or Thanksgiving or what time it is. And if you know that's the case, then there's no reason to set that situation up. So try to set yourself up around positive people. I think doing something for other people is helpful. Even if you can't afford gifts, things that are made, messages, poems, things like that are meaningful to people. I think many people overestimate the importance of material transference during these holiday seasons. And I think the other thing is try to keep it safe as well as a merry holiday, because a lot of the times we buy toys for our children or gifts that are too sophisticated for them and can be dangerous. A lot of times we don't trim our trees right every year. In the Bay Area, there's at least one fire from some minor electrical person who put up lights all over the place. Make sure your trees are watered. Those are the kinds of things that you hear all the time. But the reason you hear them all the time, because every year something happens in relationship to these things. Some child gets a piece of a small toy and chokes. Somebody sets the house on fire. I mean, and many people do have serious emotional problems during that holiday season. In fact, it's interesting that I just pulled up an article that 1 in 5 people in the United States, at least, is affected by mental illness in the past year. The rate of mental illness was twice as high among people 18 to 25 years of age than among those 50 and older. And women were more likely than men to have mental illness in the previous year. And no small wonder. 23% versus just 16% of men. And the way they have to deal with us. And, you know, my wife always says I'm driving her mad, but I didn't realize that was a statistic. And so the rate of mental illness, I think, has gone up. And the 2001 National Survey on Drug Use and Health defined mental illness as having a diagnosable mental behavior or emotional disorder. The survey included more than 65,000 people ages 12 years of age and older. And the report on the survey was released by the U.S. Substance Abuse and Mental Health Service. So that's one of the problems with that is that is that there's not enough money, there's not enough coverage, there's not enough resources to handle a mental illness in our health culture, and I think that's one of the biggest tragedies. And hopefully, with the Obamacare situation, I haven't really reviewed it in terms of its effect on those services for them, for people who have mental and emotional problems. I'm certainly hopeful that things will be better. And if you look online, you'll see that an estimated 8.5 million adults had serious thoughts of suicide in the previous year. And the suicide rates, as you know, among those returning veterans is substantial. And so then I think that hopefully with the changes in our healthcare culture, that we will take mental illness far more seriously and target more resources toward that. All right, 848-425-1-800-958-9008. Let's talk to Roz in San Jose. You're on About Health.
Hello.
Hi.
I have a skin issue. I am 80 years old and in good health, generally speaking, and active. And my skin is very low, what they call friable, very fragile, and breaks and bruises very easily. And I know that's something that comes on with aging, but I was wondering if there's anything that I'm missing in my diet or in supplements that I take that could help.
Well, what supplements are you taking?
Pardon?
What supplements do you take?
Oh, I take lots of supplements. I take zinc and D3, and I take omegas and calcium and multiple vitamins and antioxidants and acidophilus, and what else?
Well, I can't think of much more.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I think that you're right when you recognize that as we get older, our skin gets more fragile.
Yeah.
And one of the things that probably is the biggest barrier to healthy skin as we get older is we just let it dry out so much. Because once it becomes dry, then it becomes much less able to care for it effectively. I think there are a couple of things that I would suggest. Obviously, at this age, you got to protect yourself from the sun even more.
I do that.
Yeah, this is true at all ages. I mean, and protecting yourself from the sun is really a very important piece. And then I think keeping your skin well lubricated. That's another thing that many people don't do as they age. I think the more, and it's not just lubrication with regular lotions. It's lubrication with what they call hydrophilic lotions that leave a thin film on the skin that keeps it from drying out. A healthy diet is no question is important. Many people feel that, you know, the fruits, the vegetables, the whole grains, the lean proteins, that's all very important. And you got to treat your skin pretty gently at this age. You can't stay in the bath too long. You got to shave carefully. You got to make sure you dry, and you got to make sure you moisturize.
Well, you mentioned a specific kind of lotion.
They're called hydrophilic lotions.
Hydrophilic
lotions. Like Cetaphil and Eucerin and Lubriderm. Those are special kinds of lotions. So cosmetic lotions that you buy, especially those expensive cosmetic lotions, often don't have a moisturizing property. So you want it, and you're treating your skin really is very important. I mean, hot water and long showers that you take remove oils from the skin, avoid the strong soaps, you know, those kinds of things. But lubrication and treating your skin gently, avoiding the sun and healthy diet, I think go a long way toward protecting your skin.
Well, I'm doing most of that right now. I wear gloves all the time when I'm out in the sun
and I keep
myself covered.
And I bet you've got some pretty good skin, considering when you're
prepared. No, I don't.
You don't.
I bruise very easily.
Well, now that's different. When you bruise easily, you have to recognize why that happens. I mean, there are a number of conditions that cause you to bruise easily. One is the capillaries become more fragile as you get older, and they leak with less pressure. You can put pressure on your hand, they leak. Some people have what they call platelet problems or blood clotting problems. So if you have, and if you think you have an abnormal propensity for bruises and bleeding into the skin, then maybe seeing your primary care doctor or dermatologist would be helpful. But as we do get older, our vessels get more fragile, and we do tend to bruise more easily. But if you're bruising a lot easily, you have to look for other conditions.
Okay, well, thank you very much.
Well, thank you. Let's go to Leif in Berkeley. You're on About Health. Leif?
Hello, is it me?
It is you.
Hi there.
Hi.
My question has to do with the radiation that's been coming through the jet stream to California from the Fukushima Daiichi nuclear power plants in Japan.
Uh-huh.
And so on enenews.com, there's a discussion thread about ways to mitigate the adverse health effects of radiation. And so one of them is soaking in hot baths of baking soda, which draws out, chelates, I guess, heavy metals in general and radiation. And so I was wondering if that might also work for food, because the radiation has been detected. It's low levels, but as you know, there's no healthy level of radiation. And the radiation has been detected in green leafy vegetables and oranges and almonds and
seafood.
Yeah, well, seafood. I'm vegan now because radiation magnifies in dairy and meat. But as far as the vegetables, I'm wondering if soaking them in the baking soda solution would also help chelate the radiation out of them.
Well, you got me on that one. I really couldn't. I don't have any background in that. I can't really be helpful to you. I know that there are people concerned about the amount of radiation that's been found since these leakages, but I don't know much about that, and so I can't really be very helpful.
Okay, well, thank you for your honesty.
But thank you for bringing it up, though. I think it is important that people recognize that there are always these things out there that we're not paying attention to, and I appreciate your taking the time.
I guess our general building our immunity, like taking supplements and antioxidants, is always good.
It's always good. I mean, there are always some basic principles that work for everybody. Exercise, diet, you know, high and low in fats, relatively modest in carbs, high in protein. Those are always good basic things to do for any condition.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm not really familiar with how we could deradiate some of the things that have happened as a result of disasters from other parts of the world.
Well, you mentioned protein. What do you think is the best source of protein for vegans?
Well, you know, it's not an area for me. I know beans are a good source. I'm sure they're, you know, it's easy to find those things. I'm not a vegan in that sense. I'm a high protein, low fat, low carb seafood person, and so on. I don't really know this, but I'm sure there are lots of people out there who can help us. And if they would just call 848-4425 or 1-800-958-9008, I would appreciate that, and I'm sure you would as well. So thank you for calling us and alerting us to that problem, and stay with us and get back to us at another time.
Thank you.
All right, 848-4425, 1-800-958-9008. It's open mics for just about everything. So if you've got a problem, it's the least expensive second opinion in town. As you can see, I don't know everything, but I'll work with you until we get something that you can work with. 848-4425, 1-800-958-9008. Now I have Leaf. Well, all right, I'm sorry. I mean, that's why I'm having cataract surgery here in the next few weeks.
You got me.
All right, Leaf, what's going on? How you doing?
Hi, thanks for taking my call.
Sure.
Well, I have a few comments for the people called in, or in what you said initially. As I still do the same thing. I'm 54, and I know I should knock on wood, but I never get the flu. And I'm out in public and around people all the time. I wash my hands just constantly. It's a habit of mine. But I do, when I do get something like that, and I do, like last year, I felt something coming on, I take half a clove of raw garlic and I chew it up and I breathe it in as I chew it. And I do that when I go to bed and when I wake up. And it seems to just knock it down every single time.
No, a lot of people feel that garlic has that property. You know, I think that that you can buy it, you know, in health food stores. I know a few people who eat it naturally, but are you a natural garlic eater?
Yeah, I just eat half the clove. You can't eat too much more. Your body really doesn't want you to do it.
And you can't be around many people.
But, yeah, right. But
that's probably why you don't get the flu.
No, I think it's an antimicrobial, and it enters your body through the lungs.
No, I was just being facetious.
Yeah, I know. So the other thing I want to say is regarding depression. The one of the problems with the Christmas depression is you only have once a year or maybe Thanksgiving to practice it twice a year. And so I've been practicing. I have my mother is very disruptive and splits her family apart. So I'm now talking to my twin sister again. But so every year for like about the last 15 years, I haven't had Christmas. In the last few years, I've been really meditating on that and what that means and dropping my expectations. So last year was pretty good. And this year, I have no feelings, anxiety whatsoever. And I've been kind of saying that for a few years, but really now. So you really, it's about not doing everything you can this year, but it takes more time because you only get to practice once.
Right.
So this year, kind of let it all go. Maybe do not go or don't go and just let all those obligations go. It'll be a little bit better this year, and then do that for the next year, and then maybe in a year or two it'll get better.
Yeah, well, thanks for that advice. And I think this issue about garlic and its antioxidant properties is a really good piece of advice as well. That's why I love this program. Thank you very much, Sleeve.
You're welcome.
Have a happy holiday. All right, now let's go now to Jess in Oakland. Jesse, you're on About Health.
Hi, Dr. Abadar. Great show.
Thank you, man.
The lady that was talking about, the vegetarian lady, right. I hope she's still on. What she should do, she should, like, do research, like, you know what I'm saying, good books on vegetarians, you know what I'm saying?
Uh-huh.
She should, like, you know, should read up on it, like I'm saying, do her homework, because it's important, because, like, you know what I'm saying, she can hurt herself if she, like, you know, don't know to do a vegetarian, because, like, you know what I'm saying, your body, really, it goes into shock when you become a vegetarian from meat eater. So she should do research, like, you know, good books on vegetarians, or, like, you know, what the balance is for, as like, you know, the diet should be. I know a few things, like you definitely should have beans and rice together. Whole grain rice with beans and rice, that'd be a good a basic protein for her. And she should, like, you know, take magnesium, vegetarian magnesium pills, and, like, different vitamins around that. But I said, like, the main thing, she should, like, good books on vegetarians who have experience being a vegetarian and, like, read up on it and learn from it before she do it so she don't hurt herself.
Yeah, you know, that's a good piece of advice, because so many people go become vegetarians and they just think it's about vegetables.
Right.
But it really is about putting together a balanced diet.
Exactly. It's very important.
Around,
and they hurt themselves.
Around
yeah.
vegetables. And I think that it does take work.
Right. You have to do, like, research. Like, come and check out, like, you know, people and, like, you know, eggs, and maybe have some friends who are vegetarians, or, like, definitely read on it. Make sure she get that balance. She need that balanced protein, because if she don't, she can be in trouble.
You know, there are a lot of websites, too, that will give you good information.
Very good idea.
About
yeah.
how to get balance, and lots of books out there. But I do think the important point is that if don't just go vegetable.
No, go
and just think because you're eating grains and beans, and that's all there is to it.
Right, and it's dangerous, because people do that sometimes. They just think, like, you know, I want to be a vegetarian, and they drop the meat, and their body go into shock, because, like, before you come to vegetarian, you have to gradually work off that. You just can't just drop it, you know what I'm saying, because your body's not used to, like, just going from meat to, like, you know, like you say, greens, or don't even know what you're doing. Yeah. You get in trouble. Like, so do research, and, like, you know what I'm saying, like you said, go on websites and find out what it's about.
Yeah, there's soy, tofu, there are lots of things, but you have to be organized.
Balance, have to get balance.
And we said that many times before, that you really have to be organized in order to be an effective vegetarian.
You really do. Well-balanced
research. Well, thank you, man. I mean, I appreciate you taking the time to call us and give us that advice. I know that you become a vegetarian and very active, and you've been very helpful to us on this program, so thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, let's go to Mickey. You're on About Health.
Oh, yes. Doctor, somebody distracted me, but I did understand that you were talking about the benefits of baking soda, so I really had to call back and ask you to give me the bottom line, just exactly what are the operation of the baking soda on the rejuvenation and protection of the body, the skin.
Well, you know, we weren't talking about it relative to the skin. She was talking about relative to the radiation that might be coming from Japan, and that baking soda has some impact on the radiation.
And as a medicant to
And she was wondering whether it would work with vegetables, and I told her that I really didn't know. Now, what we did have last week, you may not have listened to us,
no.
a dentist who said that one of the things that he does in order to clean his teeth is a combination of I think it was baking soda.
It is baking soda. My grandmother used that.
Baking soda with hydrogen peroxide. Now, I'm not...
Hydrogen peroxide. Nah, that's a little too strenuous for me.
I'm not vouching for that.
I'm scared of hydrogen peroxide.
But he swore by that, so baking soda's come up more than one time. But thank you for calling.
I think it is baking soda.
All right, well, thank you for calling.
Thank you. Good luck to you.
All right, let's go to Oakland and talk to Ed. You're on About Health. Ed?
Yes.
Your turn.
Good afternoon, doctor. 46-year-old man, 265 pounds. I've always loved water, but I sometimes had to force myself to drink it. Now I can't quench my thirst, and I'm not being able to sleep all night. I'm having to get up and urinate a couple of times a night, and I'm very thirsty even at that time, so I find myself taking a little bit of water, going back to bed.
Right.
And I actually am embarrassed to admit it, but I kind of, you know, couldn't hold it one night and woke me up, and I had to, you know, get to the bathroom very quickly.
Sounds like diabetes is a real possibility. You know, when people are going to ketoacidosis, the first thing that happens, they start drinking a lot, they start urinating a lot.
Okay.
So that's the first thing you have to be concerned about. So urinary tract infections can sometimes do that, but this sounds an awful lot like ketoacidosis. So you need to get to your doctor, get your blood sugar looked at, and call us back and let us know what happened. But that, I've seen this happen many, many times. People start losing weight. They're happy to lose the weight, but they're losing it because they're losing protein in the urine, and they're dragging fluid with it. So you need to go to see your doctor as soon as possible, or your health care provider, and have that sugar measured.
Yes, sir. Okay, I'll keep you informed.
All right, thank you, man.
848-4425,
1-800-958-9008. We have a couple of open lines, I'm embarrassed to say. 848-4425, the 510 area code, 1-800-958-9008. Let's talk to Alan Healsburg. You're on About Health.
Hi, yeah. I have a thing going on with exercising stuff, and I'm getting short of breath.
Okay.
It started earlier this year, like walking up a driveway. I have a long driveway, and just this pain in the center of my chest. But I noticed if I continue to exercise, stop, catch my breath, I get better, you know.
Mm-hmm. How old are you?
52.
Yeah, well, you know, I think that the one thing that it could be, let's look at the things it could be, and then we decide how we're going to approach it from that perspective. It could be in the muscle. That's one possibility, although that doesn't usually cause shortness of breath. It could be in the lungs. I mean, certain types of asthma and can affect can be affected by exercise, and exercise can trigger shortness of breath. In that case, it could be the heart. So let's look at those three possibilities. Now, my perspective as a diagnostician, which I occasionally play the role of, is to look at the most serious thing it could possibly be and try to get as much information about that as possible. That means going to your family primary care provider by looking at EKGs and chest x-rays if necessary, but getting it checked out, because if it's not heart or lung and it's just simply muscle, then you don't have to worry. But if it's heart or lung, and you continue to do this, it's nothing but downhill. So your body's telling you something. The message may be small, maybe a text message, and not a dissertation. But if it is a dissertation and it's around the heart or the lung, then you're gonna have a problem. So if I were you, I wouldn't wait more than another week, and I would go and see if you can get some diagnostic tests to make certain that you're not dealing with a heart problem or a lung problem, but it's very likely it could be a muscular problem.
All right. Thanks so much for your time.
All right, 848-4425 and 1-800-958-9008. We don't have any callers right now, so this is a good time for you to get on the line. One more time, 848-4425, 1-800-958-9008. We're here to answer any questions that you might have, and so that would be, I think, a good opportunity for me to talk about some of the things now that I'm concerned about and have been looking over the last week. One is that the anti-HIV drugs that may curb transmission to unaffected partners have been studied, and there's some real promises, some promising information on that front. You know, when people have HIV-infected partners and they're not HIV-positive, then there really is nothing that you can do except safe sex. And I think that's probably the optimal thing. But now couples with one partner is HIV while the other partner doesn't, then the new studies included more than 38,000 such couples in China who were followed for up to 9 years. And about 24,000 of the couples, the HIV-infected partner received antiretroviral therapy. The rate of transmission of the uninfected partner was 26% lower in couples where the infected partner received antiretroviral therapy than in couples that received no treatment. So the protective effect of retroviral therapy seemed to last for only 1 year, and then the rates became similar. They also found that prevention was not as effective when HIV-positive partners used injection drugs or had very high cell counts. The CD4 cell, obviously, is the one. And so that there is some protection, but not a lot. An interesting statistic that I was looking over today, new HIV infections are highest among urban gay bisexual men now, which I think says a lot about the increasing rates in women. Nearly 29,000 new cases of HIV, the AIDS-causing virus, was attributed to gay and bisexual males in 2010, and 80% of those cases occurred in large cities. So most people think the HIV epidemic is gone because we have better treatment. But quite clearly, these gay and bisexual males represent 62% of new HIV cases in large cities, 56% in smaller cities, and 54% in non-urban areas. Now, I think it's kind of the bisexual piece that really is as important a statistic as any, because that means transmission not only occurs from men to men, which is not acceptable, but also from men to women, and many of the women have no idea that they are at risk. And so consequently, a lot of that has spilled over into increasing rising AIDS cases among women. So that I think that it's important to recognize, and I think the message here is that, you know, that it's not over. The AIDS epidemic is not over. I know many of you think it's over, but it's not. And so consequently, we still have to pay attention to the safe sex rules. We still have to pay attention to the dangers of IV drug use. But the epidemic, while there's a lot of hopeful things on the horizon, drugs that might prevent the development of AIDS, vaccines that might work, at the present time, you're still at risk for HIV if you don't know the health status of your partner. And I think that that's something that we want to continue to mention on our program. We're hopeful and obviously optimistic about a lot of the new information that's coming out around HIV and AIDS and the fact that we seem to be getting on top of it. But you and I both know, once we get this AIDS thing, let something else will rear up and become a problem. And what we've learned about HIV and AIDS will be helpful maybe in something subsequent. But remember, still out there, still important to take precautions. Safe sex is still an issue. And especially messages for our young people about this particular disorder. All right, let's go one more time. 848-44-425, 1-800-958-9008. You got a problem that's lingering. Let's go to Karen in Berkeley. You're on About Health.
Oh, good afternoon, Dr. Lenore. I wanted to give some information, the woman that called up, about what is being contaminated, how contaminated are we from the radioactive fallout that's coming across in the jet stream, and I might add the Gulf Stream, because the radioactive water from those exploded nuclear reactors are being dumped into the Pacific Ocean off the coast of Japan, where the reactor is all the time and have been since March of 2010. And I went up online to the government websites that were supposed to be monitoring it, like Environmental Protection and other nuclear agencies, and they stopped monitoring and they stopped recording contamination, radioactive fallout, probably 6 months after the Fukushima, which I find irresponsible. And because everybody, we're all being drizzled on by the fallout on a daily basis. We know that they found radioactive kelp in Bodega Bay in California. They found radioactive whales, radioactive walruses in Canada, British Columbia, Oregon, Washington, you know, all the coastal states. And it's my understanding that Anaheim, California, where Disneyland is, has the highest readings of radioactive fallout coming across the Pacific and dumping down onto all of us and our farms. And is anybody checking on the wine country and whether the grapes are contaminated with radioactive fallout from our big product up there? And how about the Salinas Valley, the vegetables? And how about the farm workers? I mean, this, if you really start thinking about it, it's pretty serious. You don't hear anything about it on the news. I called up the Alameda County Department of Public Health. I called up the public health for the federal government, the city, the county. I mean, I spent at least a month going up online and looking at it, and nobody knows anything. So I think it's a big secret of what's really out there, and I think it's, if everybody were to call up and start asking their federal representatives or calling the different hospitals or the Department of Public Health and say, hey, we want to know who's taking the readings, who's measuring radioactive fallout, that would be nice to know, or maybe not nice to know. But anyway, I just want to put that out on the airwaves.
All right, well, thank you for taking the time, Karen. We really appreciate that.
Thank you so much.
All right, now let's talk to Lloyd. You're on About Health. Lloyd?
Oh, hello?
Hi.
Yes, hi. This is Lloyd. I have a sciatic pain from spinal stenosis. About a week ago, I had an epidural steroid injection.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering what you would recommend to help ease the pain and maybe correct this.
Well, you know, there's always a stepwise process when you're dealing with this kind of thing, Lloyd. First of all, of course, you got to know exactly what the problem is, and you do. With spinal stenosis, it's a difficult because it compresses on the nerve as it comes out of the spinal canal and goes down into the leg, which is the large nerve that goes down into the leg, the sciatic nerve. So the first thing, obviously, is, you know, anti-inflammatory agents. I'm sure that you are familiar with them. Then there's the physical therapy, and I find that's really very helpful. Physical therapy, our acupuncture, acupressure, a lot of those what we call non-traditional methods can be extremely effective in this category. I find that chiropractic as well as acupuncture as well as physical therapy can all be helpful. Physical therapy, I think, most reliably, because most physical therapists are pretty well trained in what to do to try to give you a little bit more space in that canal. I think the second level issue is the issue of the epidural. Obviously, epidurals are very helpful, very necessary in many patients because of the pain is so intense that ordinary anti-inflammatory agents will not control it all the time. But there's some problems with epidurals. They're usually quite effective in reducing the discomfort and maybe some of the inflammation that goes on in these kinds of conditions. But you don't want to get too many, and in fact, some suggestion that they deal with, they affect the bone mass in those areas. But I think that if you need an epidural, then you have to have it. I think surgery is absolutely the last resort. I mean, I think there comes a time when, you know, you figure everything else is not working, and then that's the time to consider doing surgery. But surgery is the one thing that that you have to do as a last resort. There are all these other options, good solid physical therapy programs, good solid approaches from chiropractors or other healers, anti-inflammatory agents. All that has to be put into the mix for any one individual patient. And then there are these, if you need subsequent help, there's some pretty good pain clinics around, those that deal with it from a very comprehensive perspective, so that you get some of the best information about how you can best deal with pain. And I think if you listen to us in the next 2-3 weeks, we're going to have another pain specialist on, because that seems to be something that many people are concerned about. So that's the process. The process is obviously stretching, exercise to begin with, anti-inflammatory agents, then things like the acupressure, acupuncture, those kinds of things. But surgery is absolutely the last resort.
Okay, thank you very much. Very helpful.
All right, let's go to Frank. You're on About Health.
Dr. Lenore.
Yeah, Frank.
Yeah, all right. This is Frank. We've spoken before about this Fukushima thing.
Right, okay.
And that lady that called, I wanted to make sure that the audience and you also realize that this is an ongoing disaster. I happen to pick up a copy of Censored 2013,
mm-hmm.
which is the top 25 most censored stories. And, you know, there it is in census number third story.
Mm-hmm.
It says, among other things in the article, according to a report by Joseph Mangano and Jeanette Sherman, over 14,000 U.S. deaths, most of them from infants under the age of one in the state of Washington alone, have been attributed to the disaster.
Now, who said that, Frank?
That's Sir Joseph Mangano and Jeanette Sherman.
Who are they now? Are they?
I'll tell you in a sec.
Are they scientists?
That is number 14. Joseph Mangano and Jeanette Sherman, 14,000 U.S. deaths tied to Fukushima reactor disaster fallout. As reported in the International Journal of Health Services, December 19th of 2011. And then there's a medical journal article that follows up on the PR Newswire, December 19th, 2011, PressNewsWire.com release. There's water officials hiding about Fukushima. An article by Alex Rosman in the Georgia Strait, which is the main newspaper for Vancouver, in Canada.
Okay.
Danny Schechter did a report called Beyond Fukushima, A World in Denial. And it goes on. And to answer her question about who's checking who's taking the readings, it says, during the critical weeks after Fukushima, the RadNet monitoring system went down. That's the EPA's radiation detection network. Lack of maintenance, including lack of maintenance and properly calibrated equipment documented by a handful of independent journalists. The system went down while radiation from Fukushima spread through the Northern Hemisphere, a nuclear industry lobby firm operated in place of the EPA's network to monitor the fallout in the U.S. The Nuclear Regulatory Commission arranged for the Nuclear Energy Institute to provide radiation monitoring data to the NRC, which in turn provided data to the EPA. Rigorous testing of food, water, and air throughout the United States during the Fukushima crisis was suspended in favor of industry-provided data.
It does make sense. I don't know about the numbers, and I don't know who about the sources, but certainly there seems to be more to this than meets the eye. So let me try to get in one more call, Frank. Thanks for calling us.
Sure.
Let's go to James. You're on About Hell.
Yeah, hi. Two things. First of all, bruising in older people, don't forget we take aspirin, and it makes our platelets a little less sticky, so under-the-skin bruising is common.
The
comment I want to make is about Fukushima. Physicians for Social Responsibility, Union of Concerned Scientists, and others all have websites. Go to the computer, look up on a Google or whatever search engine for Union of Concerned Scientists and Physicians for Social Responsibility, and you'll get a lot of information. Helen Caldicott is a wonderful, wonderful talk on how dangerous radiation is and how little we know about it. I think it will help everybody if they had a chance to listen. You've got a lot of information on the websites. Go look for it. I'm over. Thank you. Good luck, and I like your program.
All right. Thank you, James. We really appreciate that. Susan, you're on About Health. Susan? Yeah.
Oh, hi, yes. The woman, I'm almost 77. I went to, and the woman about the dry skin, right. I went to San Francisco Botanical Medicine Clinic. Uh-huh. He also comes to Berkeley once a week, usually. Uh-huh. He's really, really good, and my skin is so much better than it used to be. Also, I go to Trader Joe's, and I buy their soap. It costs about $3 a cake, and I get the herbal tea. Uh-huh. It's really good for the skin, and I rinse with dilute vinegar because my skin is so, apple cider vinegar. Because my skin's so dry. And the other thing I use is Boiron's calendula ointment, not the gel, but the ointment. And that's really good for my hands. I use that at night, and it's really good.
Could you repeat those quickly again so we...
Oh, okay. First of all, I use the soap. San Francisco Botanical Medicine Clinic. Okay, Joshua.
We had him on the program about two.
Yeah, right. He's wonderful. He really helped my skin. It's so much oilier than it used to be. It used to be so dry all my life.
Okay,
he normalized my thyroid. That helped.
Well, quickly, the other two elements.
And the other two, well, the third one is the Boiron's calendula ointment.
Mm-hmm. And you get that?
That's really good for the skin. I use that at night. Not the gel.
And where do you get that from?
Let's see. You can buy it at Berkeley Bowl. You can buy it at Whole Foods. Berkeley Bowl is the cheapest. Whole Foods, many health food stores. And sometimes they're out of it because it's so packed. West Berkeley Bowl is better because they get it in there first. And then the other one is a Trader Joe's has wonderful hand soap. It costs It's oh dear, what begins with S? Some kind of
I think that's about all the time.
Herbal tea is the mildest one of that.
All right. Well, thank you for that, and thank you for taking the time to
thank you so much.
This is for other people. That's what I like about this show. Yeah. Well, it looks like our hour's gone by pretty quickly, and we want to thank certainly we want to look for the play, and we've got the website. I'm kind of running out of time. Oh, by Anita Chantel Woodley. The website is www.mamajugs.com. Thank you to Mickey for helping me and assisting me, and thank you for everybody else who works on that, but most of all, once again, thank you for joining us on another edition of About Health. Remember, health is your biggest asset. I'm Dr. Mike Lenore. We'll talk again next week.
What'll it be today? The usual?
Nah, this time I think I'll get the Lestipum.
Uh-huh. So what's the occasion?
Well, I'm going to volunteer tomorrow at the KPFA Fun Drive. You never know who you're going to see. I may meet that cute Mitch Jezerich, even Free Will and Franklin.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
You may not see anyone fabulous, or even anyone famous, but you can help KPFA, your free speech radio station, by volunteering to help answer phones during our fun drive. For more information, call 510-848-6767, extension 618. That's 510-848-6767.